Merry Christmas, friends. Happy New Year. I'm glad that you've made worship a part of your beginning of 2022. As we worship today, just a few things. We are closing out the Christmas season. We're going to be moving into the Epiphany season this next week. So in the season of Epiphany, we're supposed to be looking for God to show up among us. So part of our worship today will be remembering our baptisms. We'll be celebrating the sacrament of communion. We'll be hearing the gospel as told through John and Jesus showing up and meeting the disciples and inviting them, come and follow me. We're going to be exploring John's gospel throughout January. So all the stories where Jesus shows up in ordinary and extraordinary ways and encounters us in the season of Epiphany. So as we worship, I want to encourage you to grab the friendship pad, sign that, share that with one another. Stick around for a time of fellowship following worship. For our friends worshiping online, you can do that using the MPC Connects link in the service notes there. Our mission partner for the month of January is the Samaritan Counseling Center. And as you can imagine, the winter months can be hard months on a number of people, and the services that they provide to our community are incredibly valuable right now. You may also know that in the last 2 years, it's been a pretty hard time for a lot of people, so certainly grateful for the ways that they can be supportive. There was a link in the newsletter that I just would point out that it was a mental health screening, and the invitation there is whether it's for yourself or for someone that you know and care about and might be concerned about, to make use of that. So you're going to find that in the newsletter. So take a look there. Next Sunday, we'll be ordaining and installing elders and deacons. So just to let you know that that service will be coming up. And then the last thing is, you should have gotten a star when you walked in with a word on it. Yep. And if you didn't get one, I suspect our ushers would share one with you. If you need one, you can just give a wave. Choir, you're good? Okay, awesome. If you need one, you can let them know. Otherwise, I'll say a little bit more about it later in the service, what we're doing with that. But for now, let us stand, and we're going to sing the first and last verse of Joy to the World. Invite you to remain standing. So we're going to begin the new year in confession. I'm going to confess to you, and you're going to assure me that God still loves me despite all the ways I fail and falter, and then you're going to confess, and I'm going to assure you of God's grace, and then we're going to affirm our faith and remember our baptism. So if you're following along here. So I confess to Almighty God, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and pray God Almighty to have mercy on me. Friends in Christ, may God Almighty have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, and give you time to amend your lives. Amen. Children of God, our baptism is the sign and seal of our cleansing from sin, of being grafted into Christ through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ. It is the power of sin broken and God's kingdom entering into our world. So through our baptisms, we are made citizens of God's kingdom. We are freed from sin and death. And so we celebrate that freedom, that redemption through the renewal of the promises made at our baptism. So I'm going to invite you now to reject sin, to profess your faith in Christ, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith into which we are baptized. So friends, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world.
Amen.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? Will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love? So with the whole church, let us confess our faith. We trust in God the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith and sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls all people to all ministries of the church. Amen. Friends, as we ask God's blessing on this baptismal water, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. O Lord our God, we give you thanks for the faith, hope, and love you give to us through the blessing of our baptism, claiming us as your beloved children, calling us to the path of discipleship, revealing to us the light of your glory. By the power of your Holy Spirit poured out upon us in baptism, help us to follow you in faith, to trust you in hope, and to serve you with love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Begin a new year. Remember your baptisms, friends, and be thankful. Amen.
Please be seated. Holy Lord, your word is compelling and your power clear. Draw us to yourself and lead us forth in faith to follow in your servant footsteps. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The scripture lesson is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 35 to 51. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy. Hear the word of the Lord. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, "Here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Treasure these words and ponder them in your heart. Thanks be to God who calls us to serve, act, inspire, and serve.
So for this time for children, I want to share with all of you about these stars in your hand. So maybe with New Year's, you've made a resolution. Maybe you've set an intention. So the idea with these, and maybe you feel like, "I feel like we've done this before," and you are correct. So the ushers got to be, you know, partners with the Holy Spirit today and gave you a word, you know, probably by serendipity, but, you know, maybe with some divine purpose to it. So that's what we're going to figure out now. So the idea is that this word might guide you into the new year. So I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to turn to somebody, to find somebody, to speculate. How do you think this word might guide you into the new year? Okay? So you can share your word and say, "Boy, this is out of left field. I have no idea why God will want me to find joy in the next year. That doesn't make any sense at all." And then talk it out with somebody, okay? So I'm going to give you 2 minutes, and we'll come back together, okay?
Thank you.
Did anyone have a revelation? I'm going to start tall order here. Any divine revelations dropping out of the sky with your word? No? Any? Huh. That might be too far of a drop. So divine revelation. Wow, that's a great idea. Any of that? Uh-oh. Yeah? All right. Okay. Any, I don't know about this. I don't know. I don't know what the other options are. Holler back. What did you talk about? What sort of insight did you think you might have going on? Kathy in the back. Well, I've been out in this world, Paula, and being safe may well be daring. So, yes, yes. All right. Renee?
Oh, we just thought it would be great to tack up on the wall and be reminded of that they will be here.
Awesome. I think that's a good plan. And conveniently, you do have some more time to sort this out, okay? And 2 minutes isn't a lot of discernment time. Holy Spirit doesn't run on our clocks, but so hopefully these words are able to speak to you over the next couple of days. I'm going to close us in prayer here. Holy God, we acknowledge that we're not always ready to receive your best gifts for us. You've given us this word in order that our searching will bring us to you, and it is often our habit to turn aside, to stumble over, or even reject experiences, encounters that we later understand to have been precious gifts. So help us to be open to the gift that you offer to us through these words. We acknowledge that we do not fully understand what this word might mean for our faith, but we receive it from you with gratitude, and we pray that your Spirit will enable us to live into our word with intention and faithfulness. Amen.
Jesus, the Lord.
I've never met a celebrity. The closest I've ever come is I got to meet an author that I really love, a preacher that I really love, and I was so worried to take this class with him that he would turn out to be a jerk that I almost didn't want to take it because I couldn't handle that bubble getting burst. So I'm proud to report he's as nice as I expected, and chances are, had I not been so worried about figuring out if he was going to be a jerk, I probably would have enjoyed it a lot more. But I say that to imagine with you, perhaps you've met a celebrity, maybe you handled it a little bit better than I did on my preacher crush, but I imagine that these verses that Lowell read to us, being the equivalent of these early disciples meeting a celebrity and how they would remember it. Okay? So I wonder if these stories weren't stories that the disciples would have told over and over as they reflected on who Jesus was and how Jesus impacted their lives. So I want to run these down with you because I also think they sort of represent how we might approach Jesus. So there's first Simon and Andrew. Andrew would have told it like this. He would have said, well, up until that point, I was following John the Baptist. I was with John the Baptist, and then one day, I met this Jesus. And this Jesus was so amazing that me and Simon Peter, we were starstruck. And so when the opportunity came, when he said, well, what are you all looking for? What are you staring at? All we could say was, hey, Jesus, where are you staying? You know, and you can imagine how they're like, oh, I can't even believe we said that. And then they would say, but it turns out to be really funny because we said, well, Jesus, where are you staying? Where are you remaining? Where are you living, abiding? And then when Jesus had his Last Supper with us, he said to us, abide in me. You are the vine, I am the branches, and those who abide in me abide in God. So it's so funny that we said, where are you abiding? And Andrew is the one who was probably always seeking, always searching. John the Baptist probably wasn't the first prophet-like person that Andrew followed, right? And John the Baptist comes along, and then Jesus comes along, and you know those people, maybe you're one of those people who's always searching. Always looking. Whatever's new, you're going to explore it. You're going to say, how do I add this to my spiritual life? How do I add this and revive my spiritual life? And then Simon, whom Jesus changes his name to Peter right out the gate, I would like to give you a word of warning that if you meet a celebrity and they change your name, I don't think that's a healthy relationship. So maybe there's more to it. But Peter kind of just goes along. Oh, my brother Simon's doing this thing and following Jesus. I'm going to go along. I'm going to follow Jesus. Well, what you know from knowing Peter's story, you can't just follow something, believe something, because somebody else does. Eventually, you have to take ownership for your own faith life. You know, they're, whether it's because you're a recently confirmed teenager, or you are a new parent, or whatever that moment in your life is, you've got to decide how you're going to believe, how you're going to worship, what your relationship with God is going to be. But for now, Peter is following along with his big brother, Andrew. Now, Philip just seems to get it right out of the gate. He sees Jesus, and Jesus says, "Follow me." And he does. That also seems like a red flag, but I'm going to assume there's more to the story. But I can imagine Philip telling this story and saying, "I saw Jesus one day there in Galilee, and I saw him, and I knew something was different about him. And so when he showed up and said, 'Follow me,' I did. I left. I followed him. Something felt right about it." I don't know about you, but I've always wanted to be one of those people. I'm a little bit more like Nathaniel, but put a pin in that. So Philip just gets it. He hears it. He hears Jesus, and he follows Jesus. And then he says this to Nathaniel. "This is the one. We found him. We found the one that Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote about. And his name is Jesus. He's a son of Joseph, and he is from Nazareth. And he said, 'Follow me,' and I followed him. And now, Nathaniel, I'm showing up to tell you, this is it. You got to come. You got to come and see this. You got to meet this man," right? So Philip's that one who is just leading the charge, filled with faith, inviting others. He's the one we want to be, right? Well, so Nathaniel is a bit of a skeptic. Nathaniel is a bit of a skeptic, and Jesus seems to acknowledge that. And Nathaniel hears that Jesus is from Nazareth, and he is read enough, he is well informed enough to know that somewhere in the Bible it tells you nothing good can come out of Nazareth. So if this Messiah that told you, "Follow me," maybe that's not great, Brother Philip. Well, Philip, come and see. Come and see for yourself. What harm can it be? Now, you might also have thought around Nathaniel's skeptical time that he was quoting from the musical Hamilton. Well, no, he's not. That's not how time works. But both Hamilton and Nathaniel are quoting from the prophet Micah, where, you know, we hear George Washington sing about sitting under his own vine and fig tree. So Nathaniel, we're supposed to be told, is someone who maybe has their own farm, has some means that he can take his rest sitting under that fig tree. So that's what we are supposed to learn about Nathaniel, skeptical as he is. But so I want to invite you to think about which one of those stories connects with where you are at the beginning of 2022. Are you the person looking for that thing to revive your spiritual life like Andrew? Are you Peter following along because you've always followed along? Are you Philip, ready to roll, telling others, "Come and see, find out for yourself"? Are you Nathaniel, filled with questions, wondering, what could this really be? Maybe you're somebody else. And maybe you can think of the ways you've been in each of those places over the last year, the last 5 years, whatever it may be. But each of us in our journey is probably occupied one or more of those spots, and perhaps another one that you are thinking to yourself. But what I wonder is, what's the story that you tell about your own journey of faith? What's your Jesus the celebrity story? Where were you? How did encountering Jesus make you feel? Were you overcome with joy and rushing to follow? Were you filled with questions that you're still sorting out? But what is your own story? Because I think you got to have that anchor point. You got to have that beginning point that you can articulate to yourself, that you can share with others. If you don't have that anchor point, you're never going to get to the point of saying, come and see. If you don't have that fixed point in your own faith journey, come and see seems a bit empty. Come and see this thing I haven't figured out for myself. Come and see this one who knows everything about me and loves me anyway. That's what we'll hear down the line here. But so, no matter where they were on their journeys of faith, these four, no matter where they were, the same invitation came to them. Come and see. Follow me. No matter where you are, friends, that same invitation comes to you today, tomorrow. Come and see. Follow me. Those questions that you have, come and see. Put them to the test with Jesus. Let Jesus meet you where you are. Encounter you. Encounter him. Come and see. Follow me. In this Epiphany season, in this time of being on the lookout for God to show up among us, you know, just like that manger in Bethlehem, just like Christmas time, God dwells with us now. But rarely do we slow down to find God among us. So in this beginning of a new year, slow down enough to go and see, to open your eyes to God among you right now. This invitation to find God in places that surprise you, among people who surprise you. Be open. Be open in this season. And what I hope you hear me saying is that where you are is where you are. And God is with you there. Maybe these words help to help you to see God with you right now. Maybe. Maybe the intentionality that a new year can bring can help you hear where God is calling you. Follow me. There isn't a right place. There is only the place you are today. But always, Jesus bids you, follow me. Come and see. Come and see God at work among you. Friends, thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you. please be seated. As we prepare to share the sacrament of communion, I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward where we can respond to God's grace in our lives through the giving of our offerings to support the mission and ministry of this congregation and our mission partner for January, the Samaritan Counseling Center. So whether you use the offering plate or the online giving link, I would invite you to give as you're able today. Please come forward.
One of the ways that God invites us to come to be is through the sacraments. St. Augustine called them visible signs of invisible grace. So whether at the font or at the table, we are invited to come and see. At the communion table, we are reminded of the story of Jesus meeting the disciples on the road to Emmaus, where Jesus had been walking along like a stranger to the disciples. And it's when Jesus had taken bread and broke it, that was the moment that they recognized that Jesus was present among us. So we come to the table trusting, believing, filled with faith that no matter how we come, God comes to us. In these bits of bread, in these drops of juice, we are in God's presence. So friends, as we share this meal, you're going to come up the center aisle. You're going to receive two cups, one with juice and one with bread. You're going to return to your seat, and when you're landed, you can take and eat. If you would like to be served in your seat, you can give a wave and we'll lend a hand. But we do this, friends, at the beginning of the new year, confident in God's grace, reminded of God's grace to start the year. So I'm going to invite you to pray with me, friends. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to hear our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, God of majesty and splendor. By your power, you created all that is, making a universe out of chaos, ruling over all things in love. Throughout the ages, you called your people to love and to serve you and to be your light among the nations. When we failed you, you did not fail us, and you sent prophets to call us back to your ways. And so we praise you that in the fullness of time, you revealed your love by sending your Son, Jesus, to be the light of the world. He came to heal our brokenness and to set before us the ways of justice and peace. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He was born to dwell among us, full of your grace and truth. In him we have seen your glory. He lived for you, spoke your truth, showed your love, lavished with gifts from the Magi. He gave his life for others, baptized in the Jordan by John. He poured out his life in mercy for all. Turning water into the wine at a wedding, he transformed sorrow into joy. In his death on the cross, he overcame death. Rising from the tomb, he raised us to eternal life and made with us a new covenant of water and the Spirit. And so now, O gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. And as this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Shine in our hearts, O God, with the radiance of Christ's presence, that our lives may show forth his love in this weary world. We come into this gathering to worship you, God, and we come with worry and weariness in our hearts. Meet us with your grace. We pray, God, for family members who have been hospitalized, for loved ones afflicted by fires in Colorado, for needs that go unspoken today that only you know, God. Send us to befriend the lost, to serve the poor, to reconcile with our enemies and to love our neighbors, keeping us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, we give thanks that the Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." So friends, as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, with this bread and this cup, we remember that Christ dwells among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection, and we look forward with hope to his coming again. These are the gifts of God, and they are made ready for the people of God. Come to the table, friends, for all is ready. Thank you. Let us stand and pray. Loving and gracious God, from east and west, from north and south, you have gathered us at your table, called us your beloved, and fed us from your body. Transform us to be your body in the world, and fortify us by your Spirit,
so that we may serve.
Friends, you have remembered your baptism. You have received the body and blood of Christ, sustained by God's grace this day, friends. May your star word lead you to follow Christ more faithfully, to trust Christ more deeply, and may you respond to Christ's invitation to come and see that you indeed will go and meet Christ where Christ meets you. Receive this blessing as we go today. Friends, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Honor all creation. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the love of God, the light of Christ, and the power and communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Go in peace. Amen.